I'm losing my hair many years from now. Will you still be sending me a Valentine? Birthday greetings, bottle of wine. If I get out to 2:45, would you lock the door? Will you still need me? Will you still feed me when I'm 64?
Well, my wife and I have long passed age 64, and I guess you can say she still needs me, or at least I still need her. She still feeds me. Now that we passed that age, we've been married 48 years as of last December, and hope for many, many more happy years. I'm Jess Peterson, and this is Amazing Stories. Today, we're going to talk about aging in America. We'll be looking at how older adults have been treated throughout our history, plus look at some more fairly current statistics. A couple of sources I want to reference in this lecture. They're both by one of my favorite historians, David Hackett Fisher. Neither one of them are very current, but they certainly can speak to the history of America as the way that older adults have been treated, been honored, whatever. The first is Growing Old in America. It was written in 1978. Some good history there. The second one is called Albion Seed, and you can see it's not a small book, but it's certainly worth reading. And if you're really interested in the history of America, particularly some of the colonial times, you'll enjoy David Hackett Fisher's Albion Seeds, and we'll come back to those in a little bit. So if we're going to talk about aging America, we first need to get a definition of what aging is, because it can be considered many things. Five concepts I want to look at here. The first is aging is chronological aging. So this is how many years old are you, the number of years that you have lived. And this is beneficial because it really satisfies a point for bureaucratic rules, for policies, as to who gets what, as to who's eligible for certain things, such as Social Security, who's not eligible for it. And so in many ways, it helps us have a cutoff point, have a year to say, okay, he's 65, he's old. Pure and simple, just like that. And of course, we know it's not that simple, because really chronological age is probably the worst way to define aging. And it's going to tend to misclassify somebody somewhere along the line in a number of areas. Number two concept, biological or physical aging. And of course, this highlights the changes in the body features that through growth, through deterioration, the effect that age has on the organs, on the senses, on the skin, on the hair, on bones, on all parts of the body. And of course, this differs by species. It just differs by gender. It differs by family. Your genetical makeup changes the way you age. And it differs individually. My brother and I are 2 years apart, and yet we have aged quite differently. The study of physical or biological aging examines the causes and the consequences of the body's declining capacity to renew itself, the physical effects of bodily aging, and the means for preventing, treating, or compensating for illness or disability caused by or related to physical aging. Couple of pictures I want you to notice here, three actually. First, Abraham Lincoln. If you look at him during his 4 years in the White House, this is Lincoln, the top left picture, age 52. The bottom left is age 56. And on the right are masks of his face. That was very common to be done back then. The mask on the bottom right was taken just days actually before he was assassinated. You can see the humongous difference that stress can have on aging. And though at 56, you would still, most of us would still consider him a young man, he certainly did not look 56, and the face mask shows that a lot. Look here at George W. Bush, his 8 years in the White House, from age 55 to age 62, a little bit older than Lincoln. You can see how young he looked at 55, then how he had aged, particularly his hair coloring, wrinkles on his face during those 8 years. The same way with Barack Obama, from 2009 to 2016. I think we mostly notice in Obama, these days, the how white his hair has gotten. He's certainly looked a very young man in 2009. Now, interestingly, if you look at pictures of Donald Trump from 2016 to 2020, you're not going to see a noticeable difference. His hair is a little bit lighter than it was in 2016. Has a few more wrinkles under his eyes, he really hasn't physically aged that much. And so you can say that physical aging sometimes depends upon your attitude toward it. And personally, President Trump had lots of energy that he was that he generated. Whether you agree or disagree with him, you have to acknowledge the fact that he was has been quite an energetic man. Third concept: psychological aging. How old does a person think of himself be? Now, some people feel really old at 25. Some people, certain ages, the decade ages, they really strike. I was talking with one of our public officials here the other week, and he's coming up on one of those decade age numbers, and he says, "I really take those hard." Of course, there's not a reason to. So this psychological aging, you focus on sensory processes, on perception, coordination, mental capacity, human development, personality, and coping ability as we age. The picture there is of Satchel Paige. Satchel Paige was a professional baseball player who pitched for the last time at the age of 65. So you could say that Satchel Paige aged well, especially psychological aging. Physical aging, yes, but psychological aging as well. A couple of things, quotes from Satchel Paige. How old would you be if you didn't know how old you are? And age is a case of mind over matter. If you don't mind, it don't matter. Good quotes from Satchel Paige. So it's a very important concept in aging, your psychological aging. And then there is social aging, the fourth concept. And this is determined by what other people think, how old they think you are. Focuses on the interaction of the individual and the society in which the individual lives. It varies according to the social surrounding in which the individual participates. Social aging would include such topics as attitudes, values, beliefs, social roles, self-image, and adjustment to aging. How other people look at us. And we may feel like we are 50 years old, and other people say, "Boy, they sure have aged. They sure are old." And isn't it true that we, when we've grown up with people, we tend to look at them and think, "Do I look that old, or do I seem that old, or is it just them?" And then there's functional aging. So functional aging is a combination of your chronological aging, your physical aging, psychological aging, and social aging, just bringing all these factors together. And so it uses the attributes of appearance, mobility, strength, mental capacity, how you feel about yourself, how others feel about you, see you, and uses these to assign sort of a broad age category, such as middle age and old age. And really, this concept is the truest type of aging because it brings everything together. But this is, it's seldom used in research because, hey, how do you assess it? How do you define how old a person is from a functional standpoint, bringing all of these in? There's nothing to quantify it. Now, as gerontologist, and I consider myself a gerontologist, I have a master's of gerontology from Abilene Christian as of 1998. So to look at older adults in three different areas. The old, and these are the frail, the fragile old, those who can't get around, and we simply call them the no-goers. They're not going anywhere, and many of these would be our nursing home residents or are those who are certainly either bedridden or just can't get out at all. And then there's the old. There are the slow goers. They may get out, be able to be taken out and go to the grocery store or something like that. It'd be something short, would not walk a long distance. And then you have the young old, and these are the go-goers. And again, in these three capacities, chronological age doesn't matter. I was a senior adult minister at one point and would put together trips for senior adults. And on those trips, I would have people that were in their 70s, and they would have a harder time getting around than particularly two women that I had were in their upper 90s and were getting around just great, and people were having to struggle to keep up with them. So go-goers can be any chronological age. So, but generally three good categories to look at there. Well, let's sort of look at some history of aging, starting back in your primitive societies, the Aztecs, the Incas, the Mayans, the early Chinese, those folks in the Indonesian area. People of advanced age during that time were very rare. 60% of people were dead by the age 30, 85% by the age of 40. So you can understand most lives in history have been pathetically short, probably less than 25 years on average. And although few reached age 50, there were always those that were perceived to be old. And maturity and decay came quickly in these primitive settings. Some examples in the Philippines, the Igorot people, the prime of life was age 23. Getting old by the age of 30, they were old by the age of 45, and they were superannuated, retired, no longer to move anywhere by the age of 50. The Mongol women, they were decrepit at age 40. These old people were treated in ways that were invested in with the authority of sacred obligation. The customs always included high respect for the elders, but there was another stage of life that was beyond that of elder. These were the people who were overaged, the sleeping period, they would call it, the age of the already dead, the age grade of the dying. And so these would have been the old that gerontologists talk about. Terrible things once a person got overaged. Some tribes, according to Herodotus, worshipped their elders as gods, while others ate them. In Central Asia, the Isidons, they gilded the heads of their aged parents and made sacrifices to them. The people of Bactria in northern Afghanistan, they disposed of their old folk by feeding them to flesh-eating dogs. In Sardinia is an island off the coast of Italy, and Sardinia, by the way, is currently considered a blue zone. This is an area with a study by National Geographic from several years ago, and they're still doing a lot of study about that, setting the places in our world where people lived the longest and the healthiest. And they looked particularly at centenarians and said, okay, where are these people? Where are the most centenarians in the population? And especially the healthy ones. And Sardinia was one of the first that was chosen there. Well, it's not always been that way, because once they were overaged in ancient Sardinia, they hurled their elders from a high cliff and shouted with laughter as they fell on the rocks below. It was normal for a tribe to show great respect for elders until they had outlived their social usefulness, and then to slay them in some bloody ritual and finally to convert their mangled corpse into a sort of shrine. Well, let's move on up to the classic cultures, the Greeks and the Romans. Cicero, a Roman orator, his bust is seen here, said that old age is honored only on the condition that it defends itself, maintains its rights, is subservient to no one, and to the last breath rules over its domain. The crowning glory of old age is its power, authority, and influence. So by this time, about a fifth of the population survived to the age of 55. The Greeks and Romans commonly defined old age as life after 60. Sometimes it was said to begin in the 50s. The deliberate destruction of the aged was not sanctioned by any major of the classical cultures. The Romans actually established a system of old age homes for the elderly. But age was power. The family was organized as a gerontocracy. So gerontocracy, geron means aging, old. Tocracy, of course, is rule. So rule by the older. But the ethics of many of the classic cultures encouraged the elders to lay down their authority in their final years. And so they had the power, but as they aged, as it was seen that they became less able to rule, they encouraged them to lay it down to somebody else. Well, moving on up into the Middle Ages, Vincent Beauvais, a Dominican friar, said, "What is old age? A desirable evil, a living death, a strong weakness." Now, the Middle Ages, there were similar cultural differences, similar cultural attitudes, as in the classic cultures. Life expectancy didn't increase during the Middle Ages over the classic times. In fact, it actually may have fallen a little bit. Really not until the 18th century was the length of life in the West significantly greater than it had been in the Roman Empire. It was a world in which people were very young on average, but they aged very quickly. The idea of eldership was incorporated into the affairs of both the church and the state. You had popes, presbyters, aldermen, signors. Every house ruled by its oldest member, solely on the authority of age. Old age was honored only among the elite, however. Again, this idea of gerontocracy. The attitude toward the poor elderly was no different than some of those attitudes of the ancient civilizations. Well, moving on up to colonial America. The median age in colonial America was 16. So when I talk about median age, it's not an average. If you had 100 people in the room and you lined them up according to their age, the age of that person, that 50th person, would be the median age, even though he may still be a teenager, and all those older than him might become much older. Your average age could be 50, 60. Your median age could be 20. So the median age, the middle age, where there was an equal amount younger than you and an equal amount older than you, would be 16 in colonial America. Now, today, or at least in 2019, the median age in America is 38.1. So if you're 38.1, you have the same number living younger than you are as you have living older than you are. David Hackett Fisher said, "The attitude with which the young are expected to assume before their elders was unlike that in any other social relationship. Respect, honor, and obligation and deference were all involved, but there was something deeper than deference, something summarized in a word now largely lost from common usage, veneration." The word veneration. Now, in the Puritan world, which much of colonial America was considered Puritan, especially in the New England area, the importance of old age was really derived from their cosmology. They believed that everything in the world existed for a purpose. Great age was not an accident, but a special gift of God's pleasure. And so how could you decide whether you were one of the elect? Well, one of the indicators was old age. One way of making sense of old age was to believe that it was endowed with supernatural properties. And so witchcraft was commonly associated with old age, and particularly with old women. If you look in the Constitutional Convention of 1787, Benjamin Franklin was certainly revered. He had an enormous influence, partly because his fellow delegates knew him to be shrewd and wise, but also because he was very old. He was an octogenarian, and old men were held in high esteem. That's according to David Hackett Fisher. Evidence of older men being held in esteem, if you could look at the clothing fashions of that time, particularly for men, you had the powdered wigs, an identification with the older person, respect for the older person. And the cut of the trousers were looser, which made for the changes in the body. Well, some of that was from Fisher's Growing Old in America. When he came back and wrote Albion's Seed, he looked at America a little bit differently, because in his first book, it was really looking at the Puritan concept of America. But in Albion's Seed, he did quite a bit of research, and he determined that where you lived in America may determine where you came from. As far as England was concerned, we're talking about just migration from England here. And your customs would determine where you came from England. And certainly the customs in different parts of America were different. And so if you look at Puritan Massachusetts, still looking at that, this idea of veneration, this idea of being an elder saint, Increase Mather, one of the preachers of the day, said, "If any man is favored with long life, it is God who has lengthened his days." Cotton Mather, these two go together, the ancient and the honorable. So old age was a sign of a peculiar acquaintance with the Lord Jesus. Old heads effectively controlled young hands, and people tended to make themselves older rather than younger than they actually were. There was a tendency to turn to older men during a time of crisis. And so you had this idea of veneration. But veneration, it still wasn't a warm emotion. It was sort of a cold emotion. It was closer to having an awe of an individual than to have affection for him. The control which elders maintained over the young created sometimes some strong resentments. We'll then go to the South, the Cavalier South. And again, the people that settled in Virginia, in the north of North Carolina, and then you can go on down into South Carolina, the Georgia area. These came from a different area in England. And again, I would encourage you to read Albion's Seed to get a look at that. Sir Robert Filmer talked about the agreement of paternal and regal power. He says, "If we compare the natural duties of a father with those of a king, we find them to be all one, without any difference at all, but only in the latitude and extent of them. As the father over one family, so the king, and as the father over many families, extends his care to preserve, feed, clothe, instruct, and defend the whole commonwealth. His wars, his peace, his courts of justice, and all his acts of sovereignty tend only to preserve and distribute every subordinate and inferior father and to their children their rights and privileges, so that all the duties of a king are summed up in a universal fatherly care of his people." And so instead of this idea of veneration, honor, we're looking at the father figure as a ruler type. A patriarch. So there was deference to elder patriarchs. This was, again, different from the veneration in New England. One of these cultures exalted old age, veneration. The other rewarded it, authority. And particularly if you look at the plantation areas, the large land holdings, and so the upper crust of this Cavalier area of Virginia and on south. Then go to Pennsylvania, and you're going into a Quaker area. And again, these folks again came from a different area in England. They were not Abraham's seed chosen by God, the elect, as the Puritans considered. They were not ordained to rule the young, the patriarch, as the Cavaliers. But they were more nursing fathers and mothers to the young and teachers in the Christian sense, assigned a special sort of nurturing role, which the Quakers called eldering. There were prophetic ministers whose role was to feed the flock, supporting, exhorting, admonishing, correcting rule. Among the Quakers, the word elder was not merely a noun, but it was a verb which meant to scold or to correct the young. And so in Quaker Pennsylvania, there would have been less hierarchy than either in Virginia or in Massachusetts. And then there's the backcountry. And when we talk about backcountry, what we're talking about is those Americans who are colonialists, who had moved west, who had moved off of the seashores that were first settled. And so we're moving into the western part of North Carolina and Virginia and into the Ohio River Basin and back into those areas. And so this is called the backcountry. Again, a lot of these people came from a different part of England. And so and a lot of them came from the Scottish ancestry, from Irish ancestry as well. And so you get the idea of elder thane, T-H-A-N-E, the idea of a lord or a feudal baron. This was a country for young people, not for old people. And the status of elders just varied from one person to the next. You might have the authoritative mountain grandmothers whose wrath was terrible to behold. Others might be deeply degraded and treated with contempt. Solitary old women who wandered alone through the American forest, the outcast of their culture. There was a rule called tanistry, which was considered the eldest and the worthiest. And so tanistry in an early Irish law of succession was the concept that the heir or the successor of a chief or a king was appointed during the lifetime of that reigning chief. And it wasn't necessarily the eldest son. It was generally the worthiest, the wisest male relatives of the chief. And that would be determined by who was the strongest, who was the toughest, who was the most cunning, as they were chosen to head the family. And so the questions were often resolved by the trial of strength and cunning. And the winner became the elder of his family or his clan, and he was honored with deference and deep respect. The losers were degraded and despised and sometimes murdered, blinded, or maimed. And so you get the same concept as you go into the backcountry of early America, almost the survival of the fittest in the family. And so it's the wisest, it's the fittest that are going to survive, and they're going to be the ones that are respected. And if you're not going to even attempt this, you're certainly not going to be respected. Now, again, this is concepts from English America, those coming over from the British Isles. And you can look at other concepts among the Spanish, the French, the Dutch, and the Irish, and the German. A good book to explore those is by Colin Woodard, W-O-O-D-A-R-D. It's called American Nations, A History of the 11 Regional Cultures of North America. And so Woodard explores how cultures advanced according to where the people came from. And of course, looking in Texas, you can see a completely different culture there. But and of course, a lot of cultures are mixed. So as we go through history, there are distinct periods in looking at America and at the way that seniors have been considered. And we start with this idea of 1660 to 1770 of veneration, of, use the word gerontophilia. Again, gerund would be old age. Philia is love, like Philadelphia is a city of love. So this is the idea of venerating, of being in love with those that are older. So old age in early America, it meant power. It was either exhibited through ownership of the family estate or possession of craftsmanship or other skills. John Adams, second president of the United States, says, "I can never forgive New York, Connecticut, or Maine for turning out venerable men of 60 or 70 when their judgment is often the best." And so I pretty well discussed that idea of veneration, gerund filium, great honor going to the elders. These folks either had authority or they had the skills that could be passed down to the younger people. Then from 1770 to 1820 was a period of transition. Thomas Jefferson said, "It is reasonable we should drop off and make room for another growth. When we have lived our generation out, we should not wish to encroach upon another." So the idea that the elders should withdraw at a certain time. He said further, "The land belongs to the living. One generation has no right to bind another. The Constitution of a Republic and all its laws should be rewritten at least once every 19 years. Did you know that about Jefferson? That constant change. Nothing becomes old in his sight. So seniors should step aside. You also, during this time, you had the American and the French revolutions. And so you had change brought by concepts of equality, liberty, that was not shown in the world before. And so this not only affected liberty from Great Britain, or in this way, the French Revolution, liberty from the autocracy, the aristocracy, but it's also among the family. Younger people wanted to be equal or to be liberated from the authority of the elders. These changes also could have been brought about by a decrease in birth rate. You had to decrease in birth rate, but you also were having increasing longevity at the time. And so you don't want to have a life of 50 years under the thumb of a senior. 1820 to 1900, after this transition, so we move from gerontophilia to a transitioning time, and what you transitioned into is what we'd call gerontophobia, the fear of aging. And certainly during this time, you had the American Civil War, and so out of the Civil War, the defeat in the South particularly, you can see where, okay, we had this patriarchs, we're no longer interested in being under the patriarchs. We've been out there and in fight, we should have this equality. And so you began to have more of a youth culture coming up and more of derision of those who are older. And this was brought on more and more by what is called modernization theory. Modernization theory happens even today. It's basically a move from rural to urban culture, a move from the farm culture to a factory culture. And of course, this certainly occurred during the last part of the 19th century. And not just in America, but I mean, you can look at developing nations today and you can still see this modernization theory. But in America in particular, it brought about four particular things that affected aging. You had the development of modern health technology. And so this would multiply the number of seniors and contribute to the aging of the population and of the workforce. So more seniors coming. You also had modern economic technology. And so this created new occupations, transformed most of the old occupations. So what was being handed down from the seniors to the younger people was not necessarily needed as much anymore because you had these machines and you had these changes in doing things and it just as today in the modern computer age, the younger seem to know better how to do things than most of us older people do. Third idea, you had the growth of mass education and literacy. So again, the mystique of age, you did not have to depend upon the older people for education, for learning. It could be learned through a number of ways, literacy especially, moving up. And then when I skipped, you have urbanization. The idea of attraction to the youngest cities. And so where previously on the farm, you had held elders establishing farm, and then the sons were kept to the farm to work the farm. That was your workforce through the years. But now there's an attraction of the factories and the cities. And so the sons aren't staying on the farm. They're leaving and going to the cities for a different type of life. Also during this time, starting really in the late 18th century but moving into the late 19th century as well, you had words that changed their meaning. Some of them you can see there, gaffer. A gaffer originally was a contraction for godfather. It was a title of respect, even endearment. It came to have a negative connotation in reference to old men. Fogey originally meant a wounded soldier. Came to mean a person with old-fashioned ideas. Graybeard originally described an honorable old man. It was a synonym for wisdom. Became a derogatory term for an older man. Old guard, a descriptive phrase, was worn like decoration by Napoleon soldiers. Became to mean conservative older members of an organization that were resistant to change. And new words developed for older men. The codger, from the word to cadge or to beg, describes a mean, stingy, miserly old fellow. Old cornstalk came up in 1824, an Americanization of an ineffectual old man. Old goat meant a lecherous old man, fuddy-duddy, a pompous old man. Granny, a weak old man. Mummy, an ugly old man. Geezer, an eccentric old man. Goose, a silly old man. Galoot, an uncouth old man. Bottlenose, an alcoholic old man. And other words are invented to express an indiscriminate contempt for the age. Baldy first came in 1820. Oldster, 1829. Old liner, 1855. Old womanish, 1775. Old womanism, 1828. Old timer in 1866. And pop, 1889. At the same time, words were disappearing from use. Words like progenitor, eldern, beldam, granddam, grandsire, grandfer, grandther, and grandam, words of respect. Now, there were some terms, most of you may have noticed that all of these were describing men. There were some terms describing old women also, but it's a little bit different. Virtually every term of abuse for older women appears to be as old as the English language itself. Hag came up in 14th century. You had the words crones and old maid as early as 1530. Old trot was used by Shakespeare. But the language of abuse for old men dates only to about 1800. Before that, there was instead of a special vocabulary of abuse for young men, words that now have become distinct. They don't exist at all. So our terminology changed during this time of transition and then gerontophobia. Well, the fourth area, and we'll talk about this in a minute as to whether we're still there now, is considered aging as a social problem. This is really the 20th century. You had no longer had veneration, gerontophilia, a love of the older. You were no longer in this transition period, and it really wasn't necessarily a hate of older people either. Instead, it was saying, hey, this is a social problem we'll have to deal with. And so in 1935, you saw the advent of Social Security, which was described as greater old age insurance protection. You had veterans pensions coming. In the 1960s, Medicaid, Medicare. 2004, Medicare Part D. You had individual retirement accounts and later modified with the Roth individual retirement account. You had the cafeteria plans, the Keogh plans. 2010, you've got Obamacare. And so your question is that where we are today? And again, I'll discuss that at the end. Let's look at some demographics of aging. And the chart in front of you shows the life expectancy from birth. And this this chart comes from the Center for Disease Control. You can see it starts from 1850 and it goes all the way to 2020. I've got those later numbers added in there for you. So in 1850, average expectancy from birth was 39.3 years for the whole population. Among whites, it was 39.5 years. Among the Black culture, it was only 23.3 years. So you can say 16 years difference between the white and the Black privilege. Now, as you follow that line, you'll notice, first of all, there's a drop in life expectancy between 1870 and 1880. I'm not sure quite the reason for this, but I'm guessing that this is a time of great immigration that's coming in to the country. You've got the famines from potato famines from Ireland. You've got people coming from Italy, all across the world, really, from China and Japan. And so that's my guess for that lowering of life expectancy from birth. By 1900, we'd reached 47.3 years. For whites, it was 47.6. For blacks, it was 33.0. And so still a huge difference, a little bit of narrowing of the gap by a couple of years, about 14 years difference. If you look carefully, you can see between 1910 and 1920, you still got growth, but you have a little bit slower growth than you had been seeing. And I attribute that to World War I occurring at that time. And also you had the Spanish flu occurring that time. And if you watched my lecture on the Spanish flu of 1918, you will know that the Spanish flu didn't hit the older population like the coronavirus has hit mainly the older population. It hit mainly the younger population, those who were in their teens, their 20s, and their 30s. And you can see these are the times of life when people are giving birth at the same time. And so, again, you can see why the growth in age, life expectancy, would slow. It was slower in the 1930 to 1940, and I would attribute that again to the Great Depression. By 1950, we'd hit 68.2 years, 69.1 for white, 60.8 for black. And so again, it's narrowing there, but it's still wide. By the year 2000, 50 years down the road, 77.0. So the overall change had grown 9 years from 1950 to 2000. It hit 77.6 for white. It was 71.9 for black. And so it had narrowed, as you can see, to just a little over 5 years, starting with 16 years, 1850 to 2000. You're only 5 years behind. And of course, lots of things can explain that, but mainly you have some diseases that affect the Black population more than the white population, but you certainly have a cultural difference there as well. At 2020, the average life expectancy from birth is 78.9 years. So today, a child born today would be expected on the average to live to be 78.9 years old. That is increasing for all races by about 0.12%, and it has been for a number of years along that way. You wonder, okay, what's the difference between white and black today? I couldn't find it. I don't know. The CDC stopped projecting by white and black in 2016. So, you know, that's one good sign for you there as to, you know, some changes in our culture. That is nationally Texas. The average life expectancy at birth today is 78.5, but it varies according to where you live, and I'll get to that further in a minute. Now, part of the reason for the change in life expectancy is a change in fertility rates. So if you look at this chart, fertility rates from 1800 to 2020. And so this chart graphs the average number of children women will have through their productive years. So 1800, the average number of children a woman would have would be 7.03. It was not unusual for a man to have 13 to 15 children. He'd go through one wife, seven or eight children, move on to the next wife. And it is quite common. If you looked at the lives of some of our early forefathers, Benjamin Franklin, I believe, was 14th in line in his family, of the second wife, I believe. So 7.03 per woman in 1800. By 1850, it dropped to 5.82. 1900, 3.94. 1940, 2.06. 1960, it had risen to 3.58. And we talked about that baby boom time coming out of World War II that affected not only America, but affected the rest of the world also. And so you've got more babies being born out of that. So the rise from 1940 to 1960. By 1980, however, it had dropped again to 1.77. And in 2020, after a slight rise between 1980 and 2020, it is again about the same as 1.78. So fewer children would have been a lower incident of deaths at birth, both for the child and for the mother. And so a lot of the lower life expectancy was because of infant deaths, of deaths of the mother during childbirth. There's better medical care now today as well. So obviously a reason for children to grow out of their infancy and get older. You know, also if you look at when you had more children way back then, you had to have more resources to keep them alive. And so you, again, you had sons that would have to leave the home because, hey, the home couldn't take care of them. So they have to venture out on their own. They may not make it, etc. So those two statistics tie in rather well. This is a look at world life expectancy. The lowest countries are those in blue or purple. Those in the middle tend to be yellow and green. And then those with the highest life expectancy tend to be orange or red. And you can see that, and this is as of 2020, you can find it on worldlifeexpectancy.com. If you want to look a little further, you can dig a little bit further into it. You see the United States is in orange. And we think, you know, that we are probably a country that is, oh, certainly in the top 10 as far as life expectancy goes. But no, we're not. We are 34th in the world as far as life expectancy goes. That has risen from the last time I looked at these figures, which was about 10 years ago. I originally put this lecture together, and I've updated it since then, obviously. But at that time, we were 40th in the world, so we've at least risen to 34th. The top 10 countries, number 10, Norway, at 82.5 years of life expectancy, again, from birth. Number 9 is South Korea. Number 8 is Italy. Number 7 is Canada, and Canada is new in the top 10 from the last time I looked. Australia is number 6. France is number 5. Singapore is number 4, and they're new in the top 10. Spain is number 3, they're new in the top 10. And then Switzerland, which was there before, and number 1, which was the number 1 the last time I looked in 2009, was Japan. Life expectancy from birth in Japan is as of 2020 is 84.2 years. So why is the United States so low? Well, a CBS News report, January 2013, lays the idea to infant mortality and low birth weight, injuries and homicides, accidents involving alcohol, adolescent pregnancy and sexually transmitted diseases, HIV and AIDS, drug-related deaths, obesity and diabetes, very strong there, heart disease, chronic lung disease, and disability. Well, that considers life expectancy from birth. But if you look at this next chart, I think it's very interesting. You think, well, hey, I'm 80 years old. I've lived beyond my life. Well, not necessarily, because that's considered from birth. This next chart is U.S. life expectancy at the age of 65. So you turn 65, how much longer are you going to, that doesn't mean you only have 13 more years to live. In 1950, that may have meant that. 1950, men had less than a little over 13 years to live from at age 65. So in 1950, at age 65, men were expected to live, they were only expected to live to age 78. Now, from birth, the average age from birth in 1950 was 68.2 years. And so they would live another 10 years past what the life expectancy from birth was if they reached 65. Today, a man who reaches 65 in 2020 would be expected to live another 18 years. And so reach the age of 83. A woman, even better. In 1950, a woman reaching age 65 would be expected to reach the age of 80. Now, a woman reaching the age of 65 in 2020 is expected to reach the age of 85.7. It even gets better if you look at age, life expectancy from 75. Men are expected to reach 86.2 if they reach the age of 75. Women are expected to reach 88. If you're at 85, men are expected to live to 91. Women are expected to reach to 92. So if you think about that, really our increase in life expectancy is really coming not in our younger years necessarily, although it has changed a lot due to the fertility rate and better things happening right at birth. But otherwise it's coming really in our older years as we're adding these on. You look at the total population as compared to the older population. In 2016, the over 65 population was 49.2 million, or 15.2% of the population. Now, when I got my gerontology degree in the late 1990s, that figure was 12% of the population. And it was expected to rise, but not as fast as it's been rising. By the year 2034, it's expected that there are going to be more people over the age of 65 than there are under the age of 18. And by 2060, we're expected to be 23.4% of the population. In 1900, there were 3.1 million over the age of 65. By 1960, that had jumped to 16.7 million. By 2020, 54.6 million. By 2030, it's expected to jump to 71.5 million. By 2060, to 94.7 million. And all of these, again, are increases over projections that I looked at in 1960. Another way to look at this is an aging pyramid. And this is an aging pyramid of Afghanistan in the year 2000. And you can see it's sort of pyramidal. If you look at there's a dividing line among the middle, which gives the age ranges. And to the right of that dividing line is female. To the left is male. And so giving you the expectations of how long that those people would live. And so you can see that that very bottom part of it, the youngest, that's the where you've got the most. And gradually there are less people as you go up that pyramid to where the very top is 80 plus there. And so it's sort of what you would expect through the years. The older you get, there are fewer people there are. But look at the United States. Now, the three on your left, 1950, 1980, 2000. These are the ones in light blue there. So 1950, it's still pretty much a pyramid, but it's not quite as much as you expected because of the baby boomers, because they are beginning to age and get a little older in 1950. And you'd had a little bit of time there where the fertility rate wasn't as much. By 1980, it's more pronounced, as you can see that. By 2000, which is the bottom light blue, it's even more pronounced. And so then you look on the right, and at 2020, that's what our aging pyramid looks like. And it doesn't look like a pyramid at all. It's completely out of whack, and you can see the significance of people getting older there. Well, what about our own state? Encourage you to go to the site I have there, TexasHealthMaps.com, and you can look at there at Texas per county and seeing what the average life expectancy from birth is. You can even get it down and you can look at it by zip code level. So in Texas, the average life expectancy is 78.5. But this varies according to what county that you live in. So you can, in some counties, it's as low as 72.3. In the Big Bend area, it's as high as 86.4, again, depending upon where you live. And if you broke that down in Lubbock, you go to that zip code area. If you live in 79424, the average life expectancy from birth is 80.4 years. And that happens to be my zip code, the reason I chose that. If you look at 79416, and this is more Northwest Lubbock, central to Northwest Lubbock, the average life expectancy is lower, down to 76.6. If you go to East Lubbock, 79404, central and Southeast Lubbock, it's considerably down to 69.2. So you may want to go to that website and play along with that a little bit. And again, that website is TexasHealthMaps.com. All one word, .com, TexasHealthMaps.com. And now, if you go into that, you can find out that this can be further down, broken down by male and female. Just looking at those real quick. The city of Lubbock, as of July 1st, 2019, estimates, and this is from census.gov, has a total population of 258,662. 11.8% of those over 65, compared to 23.2% that are under 18. So you see the city of Lubbock, even though we are a retirement area, is lower than the overall United States population as far as percentage of older adults to the total population. Next chart shows household by type, and I could not find this as a current, so this is as a 2000 census. Right at 20% of Lubbock households have someone over 65 living in them, and right at 8% of Lubbock households have only people that are 65 plus living in them. You can get more info on some of this at census.gov/quickfacts. So that's a sort of a summary of where we were. I want to go back to the idea of how are seniors considered today? Or are we still considered a social problem? And maybe we're on the tail end of that. And I wonder what will be the effect of the coronavirus pandemic on the status of elders in America today. Certainly it is a disease that has struck the older population more than it has the younger. And maybe it is something that has turned us toward the older population a little bit more. Maybe it's protection, maybe it's looking at what we would be without them. I don't know. Certainly the backlash at what happened in New York, Pennsylvania, Michigan, some of those other states, among the deaths in nursing homes, may have a long-term effect on our culture today, to where we're not just a social problem. We may not ever go back to veneration, but I think we'll get closer there and certainly move away from gerontophobia. So maybe we're in a time of transition out of all of this. So hope you got something out of that. If you got questions on that, you can email me at jpeterson55@suddenlink.net and be glad to visit with you. Have a great day, and we'll see you next time on Amazing Stories. Bye. When I get older, losing my hair, many years from now, will you still be sending me a Valentine? Birthday greetings, bottle of wine. If I'd been out to 2:45, would you lock the door? Will you still need me? Will you still feed me when I'm 64? You'll be older too. Sweater by the fireside, Sunday mornings go for a run, doing the garden, digging the weeds, who could ask for more? Will you still need me? Will you still feed me when I'm 64?